Hello, everyone. We are back with another edition of Mute Me. I'm Alexis Nunes, and this is ESPN Crick Info's most loved debate show, where we encourage arguing over some of the most controversial topics from this year's IPL 2020. Let's meet our panelists, shall we? And although I will say that they are three men who really don't need any introduction, but I'm going to introduce them anyway. We've got Tom Moody, Ian Bishop, remember the name, and Akash Chopra. They are absolutely ready to tear each other apart like the feisty men I know that they are. So they will be arguing, and here are the rules. 60 seconds each to present their arguments. However, after 15 seconds, if any of the other panelists are not buying the argument, you can hold up your mute sign. Two mute signs means you're out. You gotta go back. We're gonna mute you, but we'll let you guys come in and argue probably why you are disagreeing with one another. If you can make it through the 60 seconds unscathed, wow. Well, extra points for you, because at the end, I will be announcing a winner, because I'm the boss. So let's get started in no particular order. We're going to start off with the man from down under, Tom Moody. What is your topic?
Well, Alexis, my topic is about the Super Over, and I believe there should be a new toss for the Super Over. Now, in saying that, I just think there's a huge disadvantage when a game goes to a Super Over and the team that's batting last is the team that bats first in the Super Over. I think it's such an important event. It's got down to this point. It should be a new toss where the captain who wins the toss can select to bowl or bat first. You can have situations where your key batsman in the second innings has batted throughout the whole innings and could be dehydrated, exhausted. He needs a chance to refresh, to recharge. And if that's the case, you might then choose to bat second and allow your key batsman to be fresh, ready to take on those six balls in the Super Over. The other situation is the fact that you might find strategically your team is better suited to be chasing runs, not setting.
All right, that is the argument, and you did what I didn't think was possible, going through 60 seconds unscathed, although I noticed that Bish had to look to the heavens and wonder if what you were making was making sense. Bish, why is that?
I was just trying to work out the advantage of it. The other side to just coming off of batting and going back in again is that you can be fresh. You might be exhausted in some situations and some scenarios, but it could probably prove advantageous to some batsmen to go back in, because I've always been one of those guys who said we need to have a little net at the side of the dugout for guys to have a knock so that they can feel some sweat before they go back into bat. And this just makes it feel it's the optimum opportunity.
Fair enough. Akash, did you agree?
The only point, and I really want to hear Tom throughout. That's why I did not really put up the mute sign. But my question is, we are actually getting into a situation where we might end up having, what, three super overs, if time permits. So every time you're expecting a new toss to happen and then go in that direction, then we are looking at like a very long T20 game. It's already very long.
You get paid by the hour, Akash. That's fine.
No, actually, I get paid by the word. So that's okay. It's not much.
Fair play, Tom Moody got through that round unscathed. Let's go to Akash for his topic. Akash, what is your topic?
Thank you. Well, my topic is that let's destigmatize time or retiring out batsmen in T20 cricket. And the reason why I say that is because while I do understand that making a comeback, coming back from behind, rising like a phoenix and all of that as an important part in sports narrative, but we are coming to a stage where it is professional, and I'm not doubting the intentions of the guy who's actually struggling in the middle. But there comes a time if you have an in-form Karan Pollard sitting out, waiting in the dugout, and there is a guy who's trying his best, but he's not able to clear the fence. There is the need of the hour to accelerate. But poor guy, despite his best efforts, is not able to do it. So just destigmatize his job. Okay, fine. Go ahead.
No, you can carry on. You need two mutes. Keep going.
Oh, all right. Sorry, I forgot the rules. Yes. So my idea is that if you don't tell a bowler that you have to finish a quota of overs because you're having a bad day, why do we say tell the batsman that you need to carry on batting?
Oh, there it is. They didn't even want five more seconds. Ian Bishop was the first man that was not having that argument. Bish, why?
No, that's too soft. That's too soft. You prepare a team for weeks, as Tom Moody does as a coach, and months in some cases. You go around to all these auctions and you spend thousands and in some cases hundreds of thousands of dollars to pick guys, live and die by the sword. It's too soft to retire people. You get a guy going in to do his job. Professional sport, do your job or get out and come out.
Ah, go big or go home. Love that, Bish. Tom, you didn't buy his argument to the very end. Why is that?
Well, I wanted to hear the whole argument, and I've actually thought about this very carefully over the last year or two and had discussions around this. And one of the biggest flaws in it, even though I do like it, but one of the biggest flaws in it is that it undermines the on-field team. It undermines their strategy, their execution of their game plan on that given day. And just because you've been outplayed, you shouldn't, as Ian Bishop said, have a soft option to be able to pull someone out of the fire. If you're in the fire, deal with it.
Let bowlers finish the quota of four overs, irrespective of what happens.
No, that's different. Let bowlers finish their over. They have to finish their over. We never said anything about spells. Batting and bowling, distinctly different.
I'll go to the other extent. You can even have baby overs. Three balls, get the bowler off. He's not able to finish it over. I could have done that with Tushar Deshpande against Chris Gayle for all, you know.
Baby over, I used that at some point.
There is something about this show where everyone loves to come on and rewrite the laws of cricket. It's just crazy. All right, let's go to the next one. My West Indian brother from another mother, Ian Bishop, what is your topic?
And I'm going to fist anybody who mutes me going through this. I think the Sunrisers Hyderabad, that Tom Moody has coached for so many years, and West Indian cricket, your people, Alexis Nunes, are not developing this young lad, Fabian Allen, from your part of the world, Jamaica, as well. He went to the Under-19 World Cup with Nicholas Puran in 2014. Nicholas Puran is heading to 150 T20 games. Fabian Allen barely getting to 30. His strike rate is 170. If you take out the internationals where he hasn't performed, he's a brilliant fielder. Put that down, Thomas. One of the best fielders in the world. Two first-class hundreds in 13 games, 450s. We are not developing this
game. No! Oh, this is a disgrace. Enough. This is the one argument that had my full backing and he couldn't even last 30 seconds. Don't worry, Bish, I'm going to mash him up for you. But let's go to Tom because he was the one that wasn't having it from 15 seconds in. Tom, why is that?
Well, I'm a Fabian Allen fan. Don't get me wrong, but I think you make your bed, you got to lay in it as well. And I think Fabian Allen let down West Indies cricket. He let down the Caribbean Premier League. He let himself down by not even turning up to the Caribbean Premier League on the basis that he's missed a flight. Learn some harsh lessons, young man. Learn how to be on time. Learn how to be professional, and then you might get your opportunities.
Telling West Indians to learn how to be on time. I struggled with that. I struggled with that today. Akash, what about you? You also weren't buying that.
I was actually waiting to understand what exactly was the point. So therefore, it took me a little longer to actually mute. But yes, see, in the end, what we see is he's also part of the IPL, doesn't get a gig. And I do understand that you need the balance and all of that. But if you're not one of the four players who are actually preferred, you know that there is something that's been amiss when you talk about his CPL. And I'm with Tom because we were all looking forward to watch him play. And now the guy doesn't turn up.
There we go. You were looking forward to watching him play. So that's why I'm saying
I look forward to a lot of things, Bish. That doesn't mean that they'll get the due credit and attention and time and space. So you do have to earn it. So Fabian Allen, a good talent. There are lots of good talents coming from the Caribbean. A lot of them actually do not make it to the top. They fall by the wayside. So it's slightly unfortunate.
Bish, I'm going to let you back in just to rebut anything that they had to say, just because, you know, Fabian's my boy as well. But do you think he might be a bit of a product of his own bad doing, I suppose?
Yeah, a lot of young players make errors. I've been down that road myself. So I understand what my colleagues are saying. What I'm saying is the kid is a diamond in the rough. And sometimes even with Nicholas Puran, he's still going through the embryonic stages, the growing pains of his own career as well. But as Tom and Akash well know, we've got to see what people could be and not necessarily what they are now. So I'm pleading and crying for mercy for Fabian. Free Fabian.
I'm crying as well. As people say, the secret might just be in great man management. I'm sure Tom Moody will back me up on that one indeed. All right. Well, look at that. First round done. Let's go to the next one. Tom, what is your next argument?
Well, my next argument is based around the Super Over once again, but it's based around the bowling side of the Super Over. I believe the six balls that are delivered should not be delivered by one person only. I would like to see the Super Over split with two bowlers, three balls each. They have to bowl their balls in consecutive numbers, and then the second bowler is choose. This brings a different tactical dynamic to the Super Over. It also tests the depth of the bowling in your side against your opposition. The batting side has the chance to have numerous batsmen, where I'd like to see the bowling side to be able to use.
Oh, Tom, I was trying to pioneer for you there because I kind of was feeling that idea. Two bowlers in a Super Over, why not? Akash, you said hell no to the no. Why?
Well, is it still like a less complicated game? Our cricket is. We are seeing different formats, 100 ball, 5 ball over, 10 ball over. Now we want a Super Over with two baby overs, like three balls each. No, I'm up for change. I'm for all the innovations, but honestly, let Super Over be. It doesn't happen every day. Of course, on a certain Sunday, we have three of them. But generally, a tournament goes through without a Super Over. So if you get like talking about one Super Over once in a tournament, then let it be. Just let it be the way it is. It's good fun. I think let somebody bowl six Yorkers and be a Shami or a Bumrah on that night. I really like that.
If it ain't broke, don't fix it. Bish, you're still looking at the Most High for some clarity on this one too. What are you thinking?
Yeah, because I really would like to hear how Tom finishes that argument. Tom always generally makes a lot of sense. I think he's gone very deep here at this stage. The Super Over in itself is entertainment persona. And I don't know that we need to complicate it anymore or to change it. It is brilliant the way it is.
All right, we'll leave it at that indeed, even though Akash and Bish look even more confused than the first time around. But Akash, you're up next. What is your next argument?
Alexis, my next topic is that KL Rahul is India's best T20 batsman at this point in time. He's the only guy who's actually scored 500-plus runs in three consecutive IPL tournaments, seasons. He is someone who just bats and bats, and he's actually redefining the rules, so to speak, that you can still go at 150 strike rate and you can still be so consistent. He has told all of us that technique in the end does not really slow you down. It doesn't put shackles on you. It actually liberates you. And the way he's been batting, he's actually the new model of batsmanship, that this is how you can play in all three formats. Of course, Virat Kohli is one of them as well, but Rahul is even younger. So he is that guy who grew up on T20 diet, but he's got this big or rather long form game intact, and he's still capable of hitting those sixes over covers without really losing shape or form. I think he's the best Indian batsman at this point in time in T20 format.
Oh, right on the dot. That was clean. Tom, though. You weren't entirely convinced there, though. Why?
Purely because I find it very hard to go past Virat Kohli. I just think Virat Kohli has got a remarkable record, but his ability to chase totals and undermine his opponent in that chase is just poetry in motion. I totally get where KL Rahul is as a T20 player. He is, there's no doubt, he is an outstanding player, a world-class player. But if I had to choose between the two of them in a run chase, I'd be going Kohli ahead of KL.
All right. Plain and simple. Bish, you are up next now too. We'll just can't get enough of that voice. All right, Bish, what is your topic?
My topic is that the Zayed Stadium in Abu Dhabi, the ground here is what a lot more T20 cricket should be played on. And I'll reference Tom's complexity of the super over and, of course, my other brethren talking about, what did he talk about? About calling guys out? Well, we're all crying out for bowlers bowling, the best bowlers bowling more overs in T20 cricket, and we're trying to complicate it with what, higher grass levels and all of that. No, Vizag Stadium brought the fast bowlers back into the game. We saw a couple of nights ago the spinners had their place there as well. And if you can bat well and play horizontal shots, the ball keeps flying out of the ground. Big boundaries, good grass on the surface, short balls being used. We love the short ball being used in all formats of the game. But if you can bat, the average score is about 160. And I think that makes a big difference. Bowlers are back in the game if you play on pitches like these. I won't go on anymore.
Oh, look at that. The man finished with 6 seconds left to go. And no surprise he was bigging up the bowlers and arguing for them, Bowlers Association there. Tom,
I
Akash,
hear somebody
did...
dispute that, Akash or Tom.
No. Oh, no. He brought the finger out.
Tom, you
okay. Well, the reason I didn't mute was based on the fact that I just think any cricket match, whether it's T20, 50 over a test match, there needs to be an even contest. And I think T20 cricket can become very predictable and boring if it's dominated purely by the bat. So I love seeing pace bowlers brought back into it. I'm so surprised Ian Bishop didn't make his argument around 2, if not 3 bounces an over. But I love the pace bowlers having their say. I love the spinners also having their chance to, you know, to influence a game, whether it be in the power play overs or the middle of the innings, and the batsmen to be able to earn their runs, be able to bat properly, play proper cricketing shots to be able to dominate. It's not just a slog fest. There's an art to being successful as a batsman in T20.
Completely, totally agree. Bat versus bat is no contest. Bat versus ball is the contest. But for every 5 games in Abu Dhabi, there is 1 game in Sharjah that also deserves a place in T20 cricket is what I feel that it does challenge you. As a bowler, you'll find that the Jofras, the Rabadas, the Bumrahs, they will still come out on top with that one bowling effort, that one bowling spell that will define the game in a game that was dominated by 6 hitting. So for every Abu Dhabi, like 5 Abu Dhabi games, if I can actually like argue and plead my case, get 1 game in Sharjah because it just adds a little more spice to it.
I'm right there with you.
All right. Look at that. Everyone finishes on the same page without going for the jugular. And right now I've just deliberated with my producers really quickly. And we have a winner of this edition of Mute Me. And it is none other than... His hands are already in the air. Ian Bishop, remember the name for his spirited cry for Fabian Allen. And then finally for this one that brought everybody on the same page. Unbelievable stuff there from Bish. Tom Moody shakes his head. Tom, do you want to debate on this one?
I knew I could win you over, Alexis, with that. I knew.
It got my heartstrings. But you know what I love? After each argument, Bish literally put his finger up and said, I dare you to come at me with this one. And you know what? Everyone came after him for Fabian Allen, but still kind of agreed. But no one dared to challenge him for this one. Akash?
There should be negative points for that Fabian Allen debate, I guess. That point deserved a bit of negative point. So you needed that. That didn't happen. I'm disappointed.
You know what? Next debate show, we're going to bring Fabian on and see if he can, you know, even defend himself right now because Bish is already in his corner. But congratulations to Ian Bishop. Thanks so much to Tom and Akash for joining us. Thanks to everyone for tuning in on this edition of ESPN Cricinfo's Mute Me. Make sure you join us next week.